his Six Nations debut, so all the best to him. He looked after Glasgow's big European win at Leicester in January. One of those results in the Champions Cup that has injected this Scotland national team with so much self-belief. Finn Russell was part of that Warriors effort at Welford Road on a wonderful evening for them. Now can they translate it once more in the blue of Scotland? It's a lovely springish day, mild and dry at Twickenham, for a match full of hope and anticipation for both sides. Kick-off taken in safely by Maro Itoje. A breath of wind to bother either side, all the kickers. Kickers like Ben Youngs, the Leicester scrum half, and he makes good distance with his first strike.
Split kick-off from Scotland. Always surprising they go for the biggest guy, Maro Itoje, who's excellent in the air. But solid, comfortable catch from him and a lovely little clearance from Ben Youngs.
Part of Scotland's line-out effort, that one right at the front against Ireland. Everybody called when Alex Dunbar scored on the opening weekend. They've got one of two tricks up their short sleeves. And about the first one here, Fraser Brown, the Glasgow hooker. Form this season has nudged him ahead of Ross Ford, who remains on the bench. And this is Jack Knoll and Brown, Mike Brown, England's fullback. First charge forward for Courtney Laws and Farrell, who is fit to play. Daly was hit hard as he released Itoje, and Daly stays down. The impact remains. Okay. Delivered by Fraser
Advantage.
Brown.
Advantage.
Ford. And, Ryan Wilson was up very quickly.
Time off.
The whistle. And we will delay here because that was a huge hit from Brown on Daly.
Yeah, Elliot Daly had been taken out there. It was great reading by Jack Knoll, though,
number two,
to deny the chip kick from Finn Russell.
The turn about the horizontal.
It was brought down the near side. We'll see it here on the replay here.
I'm not sure.
And Elliot Daly, head or in real trouble here on the day.
Okay.
Here's Daly with that give and take pass.
It just opens his body up, doesn't it? As you turn your body sideways to make that pass from left to right, you open yourself up, and it's good timing, nothing wrong with the tackle. Although, having said that, just looking at that, just having a look if the legs go above the horizontal. Referee might want to have a look at that.
Ben Skeen is the New Zealand television match official. Now, if Elliot Daly's legs have gone through the horizontal, and he's brought down on his back like that, he runs the risk, Fraser Brown, of getting a yellow card.
Well, yellow, and more importantly, could well be red.
Have a listen to this.
Yes, Ben?
Yes, Matthew?
I have a decision. It's a lift tackle, and the landing is on the top of the back. Are you happy with that? So it will be a yellow card against the number two, blue?
Yes, Matthew, I agree.
Okay. It's going to be a yellow card. 10 minutes in the bin for Fraser Brown. Emotions running high. Blood coursing through the veins in the early seconds of a Calcutta Cup match.
Yeah, it's just missed time now. I don't think there's any intent there to do that. But unfortunately, the power that he hit Elliot Daly with
just,
and the momentum has taken it.
Leave the legs. The landing is on the top of the back. Top of the back. That's a yellow card.
Because he lands on his back, he lands Elliot Daly on his back, it's nothing more than a yellow card, but it's a shame.
Now Farrell, he'll find some territory here, and I think England will fancy a drive off this line-out. With one man down, that's Scotland can ill afford that ill-discipline.
Wait.
Anthony Watson has come on while Elliot Daly goes off for his head injury assessment. He'll have 15 minutes for the medics just to make sure that he's not being concussed in the impact of that. And England go on with Ford linking up with Joseph, who's starting again. Joseph's gone right through an enormous hole. And England strike first. First try for England.
tackle, and he's been opened up there by the wonderful pace of Jonathan Joseph. This guy is a real class centre. Saw the outside arc, well executed from England. And Alex Dunbar, well, he'll be disappointed with that one.
Well, the one thing England have been guilty of, a bit of sloppy passing in this championship so far, but nothing sloppy about that. It looked very slick. They just held it, the Scottish pack on the drive initially, and then broke out on a lovely little peel. Few passes round the back, and Joseph, who's been brought back into the squad by Eddie Jones, given that confidence in him, back to those scoring habits. Great start from England.
Owen Farrell with that fitness scare over the last 48 hours, a dead leg in training. You can see the heavy strapping, a bit of protection on that left thigh. Missed yesterday's captain's run here at Twickenham, so this is the first time he will have kicked for real in a while. No material damage done, except to the scoreboard from a Scotland perspective. 7-0 Scotland.
Yeah, as a former international centre, sometimes when you don't get your defensive line right and you leave the space, especially for someone of such pace, then you, suddenly you're right out of it mentally as well as physically. You can't get on your man.
Just think, you've got to chase your legs, haven't you, Scott, when you're up against a guy with such a good outside break. If you don't chase your legs and get close enough to him, the danger is they could put the fend in.
14 test tries now for Jonathan Joseph. Only the great centres, Will Greenwood and Jeremy Guscott, have scored more tries for England. And this is Nathan Hughes, retained as a starter despite Billy Vonopola's return to the bench. CJ Stander and Jamie Heaslip have carried the ball more in the opening three weekends. Noel chases this and hogs underneath it. And England have tapped it back into the arms of Itoje. And here goes Hughes and Ford to Farrell, and they're running it with abandon at the moment. And this is Joseph and Brown and Watson, who remains with us as Elliot Daly has his head injury assessment. Ford once more. Dummy run being offered by Hughes.
Vintage.
Ingram with a penalty. And here goes Noel, who always is eager for work in midfield. He's not one of those wingers who hangs around on the wing. Cole, crisp passing from the halfbacks to release the tight head prop. England looking like they mean business at the start of this match in a way that they haven't so far in this RBS Six Nations. They talked about being switched on right from the off, Lawrence. They look switched on.
Yeah, but it's something that's really frustrated Eddie Jones and the England team, because the last three matches they've not come out the blocks. We talked about it before kickoff, but they look really sharp. And Eddie Jones mentioned he reckons they've had the best 2 weeks training preparation they've had for some time.
It's the quality of the possession that England are getting as well. Ben Young certainly at the base, whipping the ball out to his half-back partner. When you're playing with that confidence of front-foot football, it's a great feeling.
Strapping, he's trying to protect the dead leg that he suffered towards the back end of training at Pennyhill Park, England's base in Surrey, on Thursday. Missed yesterday's final run out here at Twickenham. Standards. He didn't kick well against Italy, the occasion of his 50th cap, but he started brightly enough here, okay, as have England. 7 minutes played, they lead 10-0.
Yeah, really important that England take those points as well, just keeps that scoreboard ticking over, particularly when Scotland are down the man in the sin bin. They want to capitalise as much as possible, but it's been a great start for the home team.
And here's Finn Russell, he's been box office this season. Talking about those Champions Cup games, he out-carted Dan Carter on a couple of weekends back-to-back in the depths of winter.
Play on.
And there we play on as Anthony Watson came back to earth rather awkwardly. Bonjan starting again at scrum half for England, and this is Hogg, who has shared top billing with Russell. It's into the high tackle about that. It's taken quickly, a little bit too quickly for the liking of Matty Reynal by Ali Price.
Well, there's an indication of Scotland want to increase the tempo through Ali Price.
High tackle.
On the back of the high tackle, he was alert to the situation.
Lawrence Dallaglio and Scott Hastings alongside. There's 140 test matches between them for England, Scotland and the Lions, and I'm sure you remember all of them, gentlemen. 20 times in this fixture between you. You won some, you lost some.
Well, Lawrence was telling me earlier on that the older we get, the better we work. And a missed kick. And again, not accurate from Scotland.
Well, Finn Russell does very well to keep that alive for Scotland. And what's on Hogg's mind? To go aerial and high into the head of Noel. Back in the head of Johnny May after a couple of tries off the bench against Italy. Steps backwards to fire it forwards.
Wait!
George Ford, well positioned. Mike Brown. John Berkeley doing what he can to slow things down, the Scottish captain.
Money's ripped.
And now Berkeley has it as it was stripped out of England hands brilliantly. Russell. Such an expert game manager, and he put Jack Noel in a cupboard that he really didn't want to be in just then.
It's the first time that Scotland have kicked a turn. You know, they're guilty of anything in the opening 10 or so minutes. The kicks have been a little bit too deep, Scott, but on that occasion, Finn Russell got the slide rule out as we see Courtney Law stripped in the tackle by Hogg. Excellent, well within his rights to do that. And I think they just got the ball in behind England and turned them.
Yeah, and Scotland obviously hit the blind side after that, and an excellent grubber kick off the left foot. The right foot of, obviously dominated right foot is Finn Russell, but he used his left foot in that occasion. Found his grubber kick. He often leaves that grubber kick too late, and it often ricochets off that defensive line. That one was superb. He threaded it nicely, put Jack Noel under pressure, and with Scotland on territory, they'll want this line out to form perfectly.
Quickly in. And
notice that Elliot Daly's back with us. Anthony Watson's retired for the time being. And without a hooker, Ryan Wilson, who wouldn't have done this job very often, is going to give it a go. But it helps when you have the Gray brothers in the middle of the line out to aim for, and Scotland secure possession. Under 2 minutes left on the yellow card for Fraser Brown, who was summed in for a dangerous tackle on Daly. And here goes Xander Fagerson, just 21. So much promise for Fagerson. Scotland trying to find some rhythm of their own for the first time, having recovered from the shock of conceding that early try. Price, he's just 23. Youth and hope in this Scottish team. Ryan Wilson not holding on to it long, inviting Reid to trundle it up towards the 22. And now Russell, this is where he's absolutely brilliant, as is Hogg.
And off one!
Lose his foot and, or perhaps trip on one of his own players on the way through there. Well, these are the first Scottish questions ball in hand so far. 10 minutes played at Twickenham.
Hands off,
yeah, they're patient, aren't they? Prepared to take their time, organise their forwards either side of the breakdown. Price just doing a great job of that, not being rushed into anything. Building the pressure, building the phases.
Johnny Gray the latest to take it in, and now the captain again, Berkeley, given the job of leading his country in the absence of Greg Laidlaw, who's our guest today. Finn Russell's taking a few steps backwards. Might fancy a drop goal, not just yet. This is Fagerson.
Use it.
Hogg remains to the right, as does Tommy Seymour on the right wing. But for the time being, Scotland happy and patiently chiselling away through the English heartlands.
You just wonder when Finn Russell's going to get this ball. You can see him right of picture. He's setting himself up.
To bend down a little bit, and that gave Youngs time to make it harder. But this is Hamish Watson, who's been a little live wire all championship. today for John Hardy, but Watson has been outstanding thus far, as he was in the autumn.
Go, boys! Inside!
Go, Lord! Wilson. Josh Strauss's injury frustrations continue, so Ryan Wilson getting a go again today. And now Jones, who really introduced himself since those autumn internationals, but England have it back with Marler, the 50-cap man. Fired away by the scrum half, Youngs, and that is defensive work well done by England.
Yeah, I was surprised that Hugh Jones decided to put the ball onto his foot.
I'm off.
It's happened a few times already in this match, and I just feel Scotland keep the ball in hand. It's what's done them proud in this championship so far. They should trust their confidence, trust their skills, and get it to execute.
Yeah, from England's point of view, that was a really good couple of defensive sets there. Nothing that Scotland did really troubled them. They got their defensive lineups and really aggressive line speed, putting pressure through the base of the scrum and eventually forcing the turnover.
Yeah. Just because I'm not running on the breakdown area, I don't want you holding on the player. You understand? They are not involved in the breakdown. Next time I penalise you, even if you've got the ball. Is that clear? So have a word to your player, please.
There's Vern Cotter. An ultimate game in charge before he heads back to France to look after Montpellier. He was christened Eyes of Ice during his last spell in France with Clermont.
Just have another look at this try. A little move from the back of the line. That's just the crispness and accuracy of the passing, and then you just feel you can't give Joseph that much space on the outside. You've got to try and close his space down as quickly as possible.
England try added to by Owen Farrell's conversion and penalty, and that's where we are score-wise, as Hughes does very well to hold on to a ball that looked like it was eager to escape his grasp. Here goes Joseph once more. He's wriggling through and he's giving Scotland's midfield defence a bit of a hard time at the moment. Jones did well in the end to hold on to him. But England once more, Bill just outside the 22 with a toe-jay. Held on to by Reid. It's another England penalty.
Slow down the rep.
Again, the problem, the hole comes on that outside break from Joseph. He's finding a bit of space in there. And then once they get him behind, they've got such dangerous runners, whether it's Laws, what a different player he looks this season. Looks fitter and carrying the ball to the line much stronger.
And England playing with so much more purpose and desire and getting across the gain line, putting players under pressure. Two players down there. Just seeing which person it was.
It was Hamish Watson who was picked out by Mattia Reynal, and this is the break from Jonathan Joseph. Still no Manu Tuilagi in England's midfield. He's had pretty much a season-long injury. They had a look at Ben Teo as the big mallet at outside centre against Italy. He never really got a run for reasons that we all recall. But they've gone back to Joseph, who's much more of a will-o'-the-wisp, fast feet. Quarter of an hour gone. First time in this championship, England are off to a flyer. 13-0. And a little bit of a complication for them. An earlier change than they would have wanted. Elliot Daly actually isn't fit enough to continue after he took that blow to the head from the tackle off Fraser Brown. So Daly leaves us prematurely. And Anthony Watson, playing for England again for the first time since the summer in Australia, is with us permanently.
Scotland will feel within this opening quarter that two mistakes have led to the penalties, a missed tackle, and it's these errors that have counted against them. If they're going to get back into this game, first of all, they need some possession, and they need to execute well.
Ben Youngs once more. The quality of the kicking, perhaps one of the reasons why he's starting ahead of Danny Kerr again. He's pretty accurate and he's not missing the opportunity to get England out of difficult situations at the moment.
Yeah, he's got that extra length in the boot, isn't it? But it's also being clear about your and what you're trying to do with your kicking there, you know, knowing when you're going to put it off the park and when you're going deep with the box kicks.
And Fraser Brown back with us.
Tipped back by Barkley and Russell. And
Farrell wasn't far away. He was interesting himself in a potential interception, but the speed of Russell's pass was too much for him. And Russell again involving Gray. Reed to Hamish Watson. Look how often he breaks the tackle and goes beyond that initial contact point. There's a fully charged dynamo right now. Russell. And this is Brown. Inverted flanker, so he knows how to move as well.
Push back.
And he tries the scrum half. Russell whips it out beautifully to Barkley. Flat and fast. Russell once more, but he's wrapped up by Joe Launchbury, and that's where Scotland's latest adventure reaches its conclusion.
Yeah, again, a very disciplined set from England in defence. I think what will please Eddie Jones, when we looked at the beginning of that game against Italy, they gave away nearly 10 penalties in the opening 20, 30 minutes. Their discipline around the breakdown, they've had to go through three or four big defensive sets, not trying to nibble in and give away dumb, silly penalties. They're just letting their tackling and their work rate do all the work for them.
Brilliant shot of Launchbury there, getting his big mitt round the ball to dislodge. But it's interesting, when Scotland have that accuracy, when Finn Russell gets into that flat line, he can deliver these passes. Farrell almost intercepted on that last attack phase. The concerns for Scotland as Stuart Hogg runs up the tunnel for some treatment.
Yeah, that's a scrum. Yes,
he's off for a head injury assessment as well. So Mark Bennett, Stuart Hogg's Glasgow Warriors teammate, will come on. He will hope temporarily. Again, 3 minutes for Fern Potter's medics just to make sure that Stuart Hogg is fine to continue.
Just come quickly in the line-out, OK? I don't want to ask
Richard Gray, however, getting some treatment from Stephen Much, one of Scotland's medics, and there's John Barkley. 27th start as flanker, by the way, which is a new Scotland record in the Championship. Not sure how many of you will remember Doug Elliott, who was playing in the 40s and 50s, but Doug's lost his record today.
Interesting scrum battle here. Neither side have really exerted their scrum at all throughout the Championship. I know that man, Dan Cole, in shot. Looking for a big performance, not just from himself, but the whole England eight.
There's been one big area of concern for Scotland, Scott. This is it, the scrum, and the pressure that Gordon Reid and Xander Fagerson have been put under.
Absolutely, real concern coming into the Championship. They conceded 10 penalties up until this point. That's another one, and it's just the pressure that's put on there. No love lost between these two teams, is there?
So Dan Cole and Ryan Wilson just swapping scrum techniques, Lawrence. Just
it's about as much as you're allowed to do these days in the modern game.
Time is off.
For very good reasons. Just a bit of alpha male chest beating going on between both packs.
Have a listen to this.
Yeah, there is nothing special. You just push you and nothing more. I will not ask the TMO for that. But please, I blow the whistle. So now it's finished. Okay, end of the story. And we play loyally, okay? That's okay, fine.
Fine.
Thank you. Mind on the elbow.
Dan Cole and Xander Fagerson both seem to be on the wrong side of the referee decisions throughout the tournament, and on that occasion it's Fagerson again.
Mathieu Reynal, the Frenchman, Six Nations debut for him. He gained a lot of plaudits for the way he looked after Ireland against New Zealand, that historic win for Ireland in Chicago, Soldier Field, back in November. He is one of the world's up-and-coming referees, and under some pressure, Young's with the ball that was therefore bouncing awkwardly in front of Joseph, and Russell was leading Scotland's hunt. Watson and co have got to release, and they didn't release quickly enough. It's actually Alex Dunbar as well, who's been one of the arch turnover merchants for Scotland this season.
Yeah, John Barkley, I think, getting a bit frustrated with the referee there. Alex Dunbar thought did brilliantly there to capitalise on that loose ball. Thought he'd done enough to force the turnover.
And no hinging.
Good pitches, good pitches.
Let's go, boys.
Look at that penalty count. Five against Scotland. Just shows the pressure.
So let's have a look at this scrum, Lauren. Sander Fagerson, the Scottish tight head on the far side. It's Gordon Reid near side to us, up against Dan Cole.
Again, England looking just to be solid. Lock out there, not moving anywhere. Ball still trapped in the second rows. There we go.
Use it.
Young's told to use it, and he does. And Ford, angled to the left-hand side, gathered in by the replacement Bennett, who's on temporarily for Stuart Hogg. Got himself into a little bit of a pickle. He did well to loosen the lid and get himself out of it.
Away, White!
Harry Price. Just his second start deputising for Laidlaw at scrum half. That's interesting! And Joseph wasn't far away. He lost it forward, but Scotland are pressing the gamble button at the moment.
Well, they're pressing the bus. They've just lost a little bit of control. They need to get some focus within their play. They've missed five tackles. These long, loopy passes are not the sharp ones and the accurate ones that Russell normally delivers. Joseph knocks on. And when you're playing rugby like that on your own line and you're already 13 points down, it's almost off. Suicidal.
Yeah, I don't think there's any need for Scotland to... You know, they want to entertain, they want to be ambitious, they want to play their style, but you don't need to press the gamble button on 20 minutes. That was more like self-destruct.
Dr. James Robson confirms what we feared when we saw that replay, that poor old Mark Bennett hurt himself as he tried that sidestep. And the man who came on to replace Stuart Hogg when he went off to have the head injury assessment is himself going to have to be replaced. And the early problems are stacking up for Scotland.
Yeah, they are mounting up. And as I mentioned, five tackles, five penalties conceded as well. A man in the sin bin. It's not been the most glorious opening 20 minutes from a Scotland perspective, and England are absolutely capitalising on this, playing with the territory, playing with the crucial pressure on. And this is where teams, when they come to Twickenham, they have to find a way of combating this, because England have come out the block stronger.
So much to play for in this match, as we were saying. The Calcutta Cup, of course, as Henry Purgos prepares to join us. Triple crown, maybe, for Scotland. Already beaten Ireland, already beaten Wales. If they beat England, that triple crown will be theirs. And England knowing as well that if they can win this, they'll have won the RBS Six Nations Championship a week early. If they don't win it, and Scotland come back, they will hope very much that England still have plenty to play for when we follow them to Dublin and to the Aviva Stadium next Saturday. Ireland against England, with us here on ITV at 4 o'clock. And here comes Henry Purgos, replacement, replacing the replacement.
Being replaced by 21, Henry Purgos.
Henry Purgos, 4 years on from his Six Nations debut here, and he's enjoying being involved in the Six Nations again. It's been a while.
Absolutely. It'd be an interesting debate. You know, is he just going down to Ali Price? Ali, you go and stand on the wing. I'm going to take over at scrum half. Or does Price stay on? I really feel that Purgos, being the most more experienced player, should perhaps go out onto that wing fullback position that he's covering. Seymour's moved from the wing to the fullback. So, Bennett, it's so unfortunate for the young man.
Oh. A season that began wonderfully for him. That famous Olympic 7 silver in Rio. Scored tries in the last two games here against England in 2015, and then that World Cup quarter-final against Australia at the back end of the year, but not the mode of transport that he would have chosen to leave us today. So the centre who replaced the fullback has been switched for a scrum half, and Scotland are having to do some rejigging here in the background.
Yeah, fantastic aerial shot of the scrum for those that enjoy this side of the game. Yeah, to see the body angles of all the players. Haskell off the base quickly, putting pressure through on Ryan Wilson.
Defensive effort being organised by the new man, Purgos. Russell has gone as far back in the in-goal area as he could, And even then, he only had just enough time to get away from the clutches of Itoje. Here goes Brown. Watson was offering himself. The brightest 20 minutes of the championship by some distance so far for England, but Scotland will have a defensive scrum to try and lower the heartbeat.
Well, another defensive scrum. Huge pressure on that Scotland eight from that England eight. And Haskell so sharp off the bat. Barkley showing his qualities there, disrupting ball.
Come off. TMO.
Just as a well-experienced player.
Put
would
it
be.
On the big screen, please.
Now, what does Sam Ben Skeen, the television match official,
yes, put it on the big screen, please.
See?
I don't know, the TMO want to check.
Just having a look at the potential neck roll here. As you clear the player out,
okay.
You grab them around the neck.
Yes, Matthew.
I have a decision, it will be a penalty kick for the neck roll about the number two.
That's
right?
That is correct.
Okay, penalty kick. Neck roll, two right.
Wait. More than a penalty. It will be a mighty relief to Mr. Hartley for sure.
Well, that's good news for Scotland, some relief. The bad news comes with the information that Stuart Hogg, we're hearing, has failed his head injury assessment. Stuart Hogg won't be joining us again in this match. So Turgos is with us permanently now at scrum half and some major rejigging.
Well, both coaching benches have had to be on the replacements really sharp and early.
What a test this is now of the gumption of this Scotland team that have entertained us so much in this championship. Russell. Taken by Dunbar initially, and now this is Brown. Purgos, and Russell's lost it. Being pressurised by James Haskell, and Brown once more. Nobody's covered more metres with the ball in hand than England's fullback over the opening three weekends. Ford, Hughes, Noel. Just having a little peek up.
It's a decent little kick. It may just stay in field, exactly what he wanted. That's a really good advantage for England, that.
Clearing kick from Tommy Seymour.
You can see the England defensive alignment. They're coming up, aren't they, fast to close down Scotland's attacking space. James Haskell in particular, being sharp on his feet.
Well, you always want to put pressure on the 10, but you've got to make sure you don't jump out the line. I think on that occasion, James Haskell knew that he had time to put pressure on Russell and forced a mistake.
Line out one by Laws, and Farrell flings it out to Ford, who'd swap positions. And again, it's Joseph coasting through. Brilliant from Jonathan Joseph. And England have a second try.
Beautiful lines are running from Jonathan Joseph. The one thing we fear in international sport is somebody of his class and pace. But the delivery from the axes of Ford and Farrell was superb as well. The pass and accuracy, it's so comfortable for England. And Scotland at sixes and sevens in their defensive alignment.
Yeah, I just think they misread the play there, Scotland. Don't discount the wonderful running holding line of Courtney Laws as he comes on a short ball there, just interests the Scottish defence and opens up the gap that allows Jonathan Joseph to go through. England now in real commanding position, 20-0.
25 minutes played, 20 points to the good, and Jonathan Joseph, who was a really handy junior tennis player, he says he's always had fast feet. And we saw those fast feet just then, Scott.
Oh, it is, and it's just that it's one of these sublime tries. And up here in the commentary box, you could see it opening up in front of him, and you can see the delight.
Yeah, beg your pardon, it's actually Nathan Hughes that ran that dummy line, and he's going to interest a number of defenders and open up the hole for England.
And it is Hughes underneath Finn Russell's restart. And Joseph, by the way, 9 tries in 16 games here at Twickenham. He enjoys playing at the Rec for his club, Bath. This is his second favourite place in the world.
It's been really well handled by Eddie Jones because he hasn't managed to get much form together with his club side. Certainly in the early part of the season, he was sent back to his club and then brought back into the England team, and certainly done him the world of good having that time with the squad, and looks right back to his best today. And England are playing to their strengths. They know that they've got that advantage and they're looking to really exploit it through Joseph.
Line out won by Johnny Gray, the younger of the two brothers. Barkley waits for it. The captain, this is Dunbar. First time at Twickenham for Alex Dunbar. The remaining 60 minutes are more productive than the first 20. Fagerson. Henry Purgos. Fagerson once more. Good clearing work to create the ball again for Scotland, but it's still not the quickest.
No, the pick and drive. They're getting yards though, they're building them in, and this is what they've got to do. They've got to retain that position.
Yeah, England getting two men into the tackle. The first one sorting the tackler out. It's probably the first time they've got it wrong.
They've
got to release the tackler on the floor.
He comes in if there is any problem.
Fraser Brown just having a word about what he claims is a high shot to the head. The penalty committed by Courtney Laws. And Ben Russell decides that 3 points, even at this stage of the match, isn't good enough for Scotland.
And certainly intent. I told you, trying to go in and hold him up, but you see the on the line with the knee on the ground. That means he had to release him in the tackle.
It's often hard to know as a player, isn't it, if the tackle's been completed, and on that occasion Courtney Laws just got that wrong, but Scotland got a great chance here.
Brown taken at the back by Barkley. Gray quickly releasing Dunbar. Scotland 5 metres short, the brightest of the match for them so far. It's Brown just short, and another charge for the line, and they've scored, and it's Gordon Reid. And my goodness, how they needed that, and Reid has got them back in it.
Well, it's the perfect response for Scotland. Vindicates the decision not to take the 3 points. They go for the corner. And rather similar to England, they got suckered into the drive and they did that lovely little peel around the back. And they were running at George Ford, and I think that kind of opened up the space. Haskell and Young's unable to stop the body position of Reid, and that's a really good score.
First try for Scotland.
Well, you'll remember that one. But it happened from Scotland's pick-and-drive play, then, as Lawrence said, the option of turning down the three-point penalty, kicking to the touch, and innovation from the line-out as well. You'll notice that Alex Dunbar was involved in this play, and there's Reid going for that try line, and that will give them the confidence to get back into this game.
Really important, actually, from England's perspective. When you're on the fringes of the ruck, you don't get held in by the attackers. And England just a little bit guilty of ball watching there. And a really good response from Scotland.
It's been a very busy opening half an hour here at Twickenham. Two tries for England, and now one for Scotland. 20 points to 7.
What is here? What is available? Push back.
Wider! Scotland have done so well to balance a ship that was starting to list a little bit, not just the tries but the players they were losing through injury. Stuart Hogg and then Mark Bennett. Tommy Seymour has gone to fullback, and they've got Henry Purgos now at scrum half. It's a very, very important 10 minutes from a Scottish point of view, Scott Hastings.
Well, certainly is, and my concern had been if they'd at 20-0 had conceded another one, then England were away with it, but Scotland, they have to dig deep. Dylan Hartley, though, accuracy in the line-out needed.
And a snaffle by Laws, all 6'7" of it. And Johnny Gray is offside. The brothers Gray in Scotland's boiler room today.
Just got caught coming in at the side there. It's one thing the referees are really hot on throughout the championship. got to get yourself legal right from the start. England deciding after conceding that try to build the score. Look at this, Courtney Laws gets up. Look at that, you're not allowed to swim around the side of the ruck. If you come through the middle and you stay bound, then you're legal. But Johnny Gray just getting it wrong on that occasion.
And again, it's one of these unforced errors from Scotland, conceding penalties, conceding points.
They all say, Scott, don't they, straight after you've scored, you're at your most vulnerable, just do the simple things, clear your lines, and Scotland haven't done that, and it's a chance for three.
Scotland 7. Now, what of Scotland's kicking tactics? Martin Bayfield has a little bit to offer us. Martin.
Yeah, Nick, it was interesting going back to the Scotland try. The penalty obviously given, and Finn Russell looked back down the touchline to Nathan Hines, believe it or not, the former Scotland second row, who gave the indication to go for the line-out, which then, of course, led to the try. So that was where very clear thinking came in, instructions off the touchline.
Nathan Hines, part of Scotland's coaching team, one of the coaches who's actually down on the touchline. He's a very well qualified water boy today, but also helping to pass on that kind of information that may have been passed to him by Vern Cotter and the coaches up in the stands, Scott.
Yeah, really important. The communication is good from the coaches onto the pitch, and the players trying to adapt to the loss of the likes of Stuart Hogg.
It's Ferguson. Johnny Gray. It's the sense that Scotland's sails are starting to billow a little bit more.
It's amazing when you actually just get a little bit more possession. They like this set two-pass game as well to just try and keep the attack from England.
It's a kick to contest from Russell, and it'll put pressure on Brown. An indication of how well Brown did under lots of pressure from Ryan Wilson and Co.
He's here. He's back.
Yeah, you've got to release the here. Player
release
in the
blue,
air.
Release blue.
You've got to release him to allow Mike Brown to play the ball. Wonderful take.
Pressure.
Youngs goes high again. Contestable. Again, England winning it, this time via Itoje. And England winning the penalty.
Well, that's an obvious one for the referee. Didn't need to do that at all. Got to stay on your feet. And again, just lets England off the hook.
I don't want you slow down the breakdown, okay? Just I want quick ball and space for the player. So if you want to come to contest the ball, you need to have perfect behavior. Okay, on feet and attack the ball.
Just from these kicks, all the people in the ruck are coming forward. Okay. That's easy on the caught the ball there.
I will pay attention, but give the information to your players. Thank you very much.
It's an interesting conversation, Scott, because having picked John Barkley, Hamish Watson, Ryan Wilson, back rowers who can all play at seven, they're all mobile little ferreters. You know the game that Scotland want to play, and so importantly to England.
And as you said, the last sort of 10, 15 minutes ago, the back row have got themselves involved in the crowd, in the game. And this is Fraser Brown. He's gone in there. He started and continued to play the bit. He's off his feet. And Scotland need to stay on their feet. Yeah. If they're going to disrupt the England ball, stay on your feet. Use your feet to disrupt the ball.
Line out again. Two Laws is clean, and Youngs finds Ford and finds Farrell under pressure. Once more, it's Joseph ghosting through, and here goes Watson, and England have three. I'm afraid whenever they've had the ball in hand in Scotland's 22, that blue defence has been shredded.
What a quality of the passing, and it's like perpetual motion. The players are coming onto the ball. It's the hardest thing to defend. They're really playing through that hat. That gap with Joseph, but look about the timing of this pass from forward, he just delays it, then Farrell holds onto it for that split second until Joseph comes through. He knows he can't go all the way. Lovely little connection, outside break, and then man Watson steaming up. It's a lovely score from England.
Yeah, more concern is actually two players on the outside as well. So hard, when the accuracy of England has been absolutely super, the hell pass there to put their men into the gap at pace.
Away from the end of a half that England won't want to end. They lead by 30 points to 7.
Just enjoy this piece of skill again. The try from this angle looks lovely. Look at the delay on the pass from Farrell. Just a little straightening of the line that sets the defender in, gets him to bite in. And then the outside break from Joseph, and it's simple after that. Look at this again. Just running straight lines, fixing the inside shoulder of the defender. I know it sounds simple, Scott, but it creates a try.
No, it is. And they've caused hesitation, and because Alex Dunbar missed the first tackle of the match that allowed Joseph in, you start to question yourself as a player. But the axes once again of George Ford and Owen Farrell, they are so influential on the way that England set up their attack play.
Once again, walloped away unceremoniously by Youngs.
Well, we can safely say it's been the best 40 minute performance from England in this championship. They've had a lot of criticism for playing in fits and starts, but they've been excellent right out the blocks.
Ben Young's dad Nick, by the way, was part of the England squad that lost here to Scotland in 1983. Dad was in touch with some this week saying make sure I remain the last to be beaten by Scotland here at Twickenham, but it's looking good for the family. Young's approaching half time.
More! One stop! Use it now.
Henry Burgos.
Thank you.
There's Alex Dunbar. Fourth game in a row that Dunbar and Hugh Jones have teamed up together.
And off right now!
Ferguson trying to charge his way through English defence. And here's Gray, Richie Gray.
Scotland, three phases, they're not quite up to the gain line where the line-out took place, and that's been the problem for them. England's line speed has been excellent. They've yet to bridge the gain line.
Here's Wilson. Charles, by the way, will miss the rest of the Six Nations. He's a serious kidney problem. Russell calling for it. You can see the frustration etched on his face. You might be able to hear his voice crying for it, Scott.
But also the ball is so slow.
And Launchbury has it via Laws. As hard as Barkley works to win that back, it's England's to play with. And here goes Brown looking for a bonus try before half time. Farrell will chase that kick. Quite got the angle on it. And Price, who's been shoved out to the right wing because of all the injuries, will gratefully dot down, and Scotland will have the 22-metre dropout.
Yeah, the problem for Finn Russell, Scott, is that when he does get that ball, he's got no real option other than to put it up in the air, because England are stopping those Scottish runners on the gain line or even knocking them back behind it.
You're right, and if you compare the quality of ball that England are getting to the quality of ball that Scotland are getting, Dylan Hartley did really well here, rips the ball out from Alex Dunbar, forces the error. And because that, Scott, just going back to your point there about Finn Russell, because the ball is so slow, he's having to step back into the pocket to try and put momentum into his attacks. Okay. And as you said, he's only got the option then of kicking.
That's okay.
Vern Cotter talking with the defence coach, Matt Taylor in front of him, Jason O'Halloran as well, the backs attack coach. It's a problem that they weren't expecting to have heading into half-time.
Please,
fortnight ago, it was England with a head full of problems.
Yeah, it's a problem,
to which
Nick,
on it's Scotland, Lawrence.
It's a problem, Nick, that might cause them more problems in the second half as well, because, you know, they've had to make those changes early and they're not going to have much left in the tank for that second half as well.
An England bench that includes Billy Vunipola, of course, back from injury.
No, that's fine. Time's up.
England.
Stop. Come down.
Finish business
that's
here
fine.
If they wanted
that's
to.
Fine.
Well, I think ordinarily Elliot Daly might step up and have one of his cannon.
Dylan, call your player now, please.
Place kicks, but they haven't got that option. Wonder whether Owen Farrell will take it on, or whether they'll just kick it out.
Time
and,
for line out.
Go to half time.
Well, they don't have time for the line out because what the clock had already gone beyond the 40-minute mark. Going to go for the post. This will test that left leg of Owen Farrell, the left leg that was a dead leg.
Not rolling away.
48 hours ago. But he thinks that he's got the distance here.
Well, he's certainly got his confidence, isn't he, in his kicking this week. I mean, as you say, 3 out of 7 last week against Italy, but been outstanding. Look at that as we bring the map on there. Lots of green, in fact, all green from Owen Farrell, and that's the sort of decision you make when you're kicking well.
And the one thing England have been doing is just keeping that scoreboard ticking over in their favour, hammering nails into Scotland's coffin.
That's fine. Good. Yeah,
too strong,
I'm happy.
52 metres means it would be the longest kick in the RBS Six Nations this season. It's on its way. It's drifting to the left. Not this time for Owen Farrell. For the first time in that first 40. Nobody has ever scored as many points in the first half as a Calcutta Cup match as England right now. It's the biggest ever 40-minute score in an England-Scotland encounter, the bulk of them belonging to England. England 30, Scotland 7.
ITV's coverage of the RBS Six Nations, sponsored by the new Peugeot 3008 SUV.
This weekend, the Voice Live Knockouts continue.
I'm beside myself right now.
Saturday, it's the turn of Team Will.
I think I got a lot of good singers that can fly.
On Sunday, it's Team Gavin.
It's now time to prove that record deal is for them.
The Voice Knockouts, tonight,
so
8:30.
For these two countries, past the midway point, just the one win between them.
High Five from William Hill. Available every race, every day at the Cheltenham Festival. 1 in 3 jumps races this season have been won by 5 or more lengths. Bet on any race at the Cheltenham Festival, and if the race is won by 5 or more lengths and you back the winner, you'll get a 25% free bet bonus on your winnings. If your horse finishes second, you get your money back as a free bet. High Five from William Hill. Available online, on mobile, and in our shops.
Kevin will be the first in his family to go to university. He'll tell you first when he gets his place.
Well done, Kevin.
Amy loves chatting. You'll get her to do it in Spanish. And one day Tamika will teach her own kids about kinetic theory. She'll remember this class, and you. Make a difference to their future and yours. Apply now and you could get a £25,000 tax-free training bursary. Search Get Into Teaching.
Introducing the all-new Toyota CHR. Toyota,
always a better way.
I'm going to get up for work tomorrow, come on.
So I'll go up on the pop.
Seatbelt?
Yes. So Liam, and he just starts climbing it. And the lights go on, and everyone's looking. And... do you think I should drive?
Yeah, what was I thinking? Just got to get this text off.
My turn to drive. Good driver.
Get rugby fit with specialist advice from the people at the top. No matter your game or goal, get the most out of your sessions. Train for your game.
ITV's coverage of the RBS Six Nations, sponsored by the new Peugeot 3008 SUV.
Two tries for Jonathan Joseph in a blistering first half display by England, who leads Scotland by 30 points to 7 at half time. And if it could go wrong for Scotland in the first half, it has gone wrong. It went wrong early on with Fraser Brown's sin binning. Was it just too revved up, do you think?
Well, it kind of looked like it, didn't it? It was crazy in a sense. It's a definite tip tackle there. The pictures are clear to see. And that's what Vern definitely wouldn't have wanted. Obviously, guys coming up real pumped up and not thinking correctly, and that was a classic case, sadly.
Because when the legs go beyond the perpendicular, it's the tackler's responsibility, isn't it, to ground his opponent safely?
Yeah, he was very lucky, and as Greg said, that was probably a red card, if I'm brutally honest. But it just says, you know, the higher up you go, you haven't got to be brave or tough to get a yellow card or the red card. It kind of ruins your whole team, and you've got to be able to play under the pressure of this and still hit people. That he could actually really smash Daly, clean him properly, but just to get that situation has really cost his team massively. And to do it after 1 minute 40, was just Scotland never really recovered from that, to be honest.
England have been in the Scottish 22 three times. They've scored every single time they've scored.
Yeah, it's really nice, actually. They're working off very similar principles here. And what Ian and I have seen is that they're getting away from the line out quite quickly, so they're shifting that ball. And then they're running very straight, which is causing Scotland problems. They're having to front up to that. Here, I think there's so much going on. I think Dunbar just gets caught trying to read the play and forgets that that's his man and just ends up a step short. The 13 also turns his back slightly, creates an extra bit of space for Joseph to go through, but the guy's finishing well. On these next two, very, very similar. Because they get such width off the line out with that first pass into this space here where there's no Scottish defenders, as soon as they run straight, all Scotland's defence is getting pulled inwards and outwards. And you just see now as George Ford takes that inward step, it just looks like so... As a defensive line, they're now individually having to guess rather than playing a system. And here's exactly the same. The same principle, away from the line, a better defence from Scotland at the beginning this time. But again, look how straight the running is. And when it comes to it, Farrell knows as he gets this ball, if he just shifts in, he's got a two-on-one there against the guy in front. Scotland are being pulled out and in because of that line out and because of the straight running and the options out the back of the player.
And as Johnny said, I think, unfortunately, they're thinking like four individuals in the middle trying to read each other's play rather than saying as a four. Actually, one single are coming at them, all four should be really closing the space down and putting the arriving players under pressure. England are working really well with players coming around the back. So every Scottish defender's had two players in his eye line. But what they've done is made individual decisions about each situation rather than as a four making a collective decision to come in and put real pressure as the runners come to the line.
Mark, the key thing is, and the bench, how many times you talk about Ford Farrell, you know, whatever you're all doing, all the runners, it comes from day one. Eddie Jones has picked two footballers at 10 and 12. And that allows you to play at this level. And the way they're playing now is so confident, they're right in people's faces. Without those two players, don't pick them, you can't do what we've just been seeing. So the selection of those things, right from day one, a year and a half ago, as soon as he came in, England coach comes in and picks two genuine footballers at 10 and 12. And that's why the England game's gone to this level.
Sorry. Yeah, definitely. And I think England are putting us under real pressure with their running lines. But again, we're probably doing things we've not practiced. I think on that last one, Finn went up and we were probably usually relying on our tail gunner to get out to that first defender. And so we're probably defending one man in where we should be. So that's just putting huge pressure on our 12 and 13 to make reads. And at the moment, unfortunately for us, they're making probably the wrong decisions. If we cut through the middle twice, if you get beat through the middle, you're in real trouble. You're better to push them to the edge if you can.
Especially if your man going through the middle is Joseph, whose feet seem to be working for him today. Right. I mean, those weren't simple finishes.
Every time he gets the ball, it looks like he's going to score, doesn't he? We'll take a break and then we'll come back and think about how Scotland might get back into it in the second half after a first half where it all went wrong for them. Fraser Brown sin-binned early on. Then Stuart Hogg off with a head injury and his replacement, Mark Bennett, didn't last long with a knee injury either.
ITV's coverage of the RBS Six Nations, sponsored by the new Peugeot 3008 SUV.
As an RAF reservist, you can train with and work alongside regular airmen and airwomen in one of over 30 roles. And you could start by committing just 27 days of your spare time a year. Find your role as a spare time reservist. Recruiting now. Search RAF Recruitment.
My days move pretty fast, but I wouldn't have it any other way.
When you change your point of view, routine can be marvellous. The award-winning SEAT Ateca, available from 17,990.
SEAT.
Bye, Granny. Bye,
Grandma. Alexa, play Classic FM.
Alexa! Ask Fitbit how many steps I've done.
You've done 9,250 steps today.
Yes.
Alexa, add screen wipes to my shopping list.
I've added screen wipes to your shopping list.
Let's not mess about. At 188 Bet, we know exactly what you want. Our best prices on the markets you'll like to bet on. Whatever's your bag, racing, football. There's no gimmicks, no nonsense. Just tasty prices every day.
Have a butcher's at that. Bet now at 188bet.co.uk.
ITV's coverage of the RBS Six Nations, sponsored by the new Peugeot 3008 SUV.
One try for Scotland in that first half, where they turned out an obvious kick at goal. I think all four of you were thinking they were going to kick for goal, but a message came from the bench to kick for the corner, and it was justified.
Yeah, it was justified, and it's always the right decision if you come away with the seven pointer. But that's credit to Vernon and his coaching team. They sent the message on. This is a set play from training. We practiced this all week to get Alex Dunbar on the, get us on the front foot into George Ford, and we're able to do that. And a couple of good quick picks from the forwards here, and we're able to muscle up. And I think Gordy Reid sneaks over, and you know, we were desperate and needed some points at that point, and good to get seven rather than three.
And I think you can see England all half have been worried about Scotland's play out wide. So they've actually been sending a tackler in and one defender. So every breakdown, there was only ever two or one in working hard, which meant their front line was 13 men. So it meant that, that Finn Russell wasn't finding the space that he expected, because England were already not committing to the breakdowns and keeping the numbers in the front line.
What about the message from Eddie Jones at half-time? England are way ahead, but wouldn't want to be complacent.
If it was me, Mark, I'd have a big thing. I'd go 0-0. You know, we've got to just start again, 0-0. Forget that. It'd be so easy to get sloppy, complacency, and all your kind of systems and routines go out. So I'd be saying 0-0. I'd probably try and get that bench on pretty quick to give them a go, because it's a very strong bench. But can we win the second half? That's the big thing.
I would be very surprised if England team right now are thinking, this is the best we've got. I'm sure the message for me as well as what Clive's saying is that that's nowhere near the best of us. Let's go out now and find a bit more.
Let's find out then with Laurence Dallaglio, Scott Hastings and Nick Mullins.
Neither side have made any changes at half-time, but lots of unscheduled changes in the first 40. Perhaps just worth reminding you, a couple for Scotland. It's rather remoulded their backs. Hogg replaced by Bennett, who was replaced by Purgos. Hogg a head injury, Bennett a knee injury. So Purgos in this second half, the scrum half. Ali Price has gone to the wing. Tommy Seymour's gone to fullback. We'll have a chat with Scott Hastings about how that might have affected the way they defended those three England tries. For England, Elliot Daly falling on his head. Anthony Watson taking over and scoring England's third before half-time.
Come on, man.
And Watson has it. And this is Courtney Lawes.
Away, seven!
Joe Launchbury for England, doing his absolute best to make sure that they don't miss George Cruz overly. Man of the match against Wales, man of the match against Italy, and his teammate for Wasps, Nathan Hughes, brings it away, and Youngs has it as England go in search of the fourth. And in the end, the positioning of Finn Russell denied them. And he needed to be where he was, otherwise Noel would have got the fourth.
Nice, wonderful break through the middle of the ruck from Nathan Hughes, linking up with Ford. Haskell looked like he had Finn Russell caught behind his goal line, but somehow the fly half manages to scramble away, and Scotland under all sorts of pressure.
That's with the kick to Watson, chased hard by Seymour, but Watson wriggles away, and Seymour got back to eventually effect the tackle. Ford, Farrell, Joseph once more, looking to pick a lock. He's picked twice already. And here goes Brown, tackled by the other Brown. Haskell. Courtney Lawes waits to the right, as does Atoje, but it's to the left, and Mike Brown. Wriggling underneath the attention of Fraser Brown.
Push back, push back.
Noel. Lawes needed to be held up by Richie Gray, and he was. Hughes, who established this position for England. Joseph screaming for it and getting it and scoring. And it's a hat trick for the comeback now.
Well, he has been brilliant.
possession that's coming their way. This man, Nathan Hughes, he got the offload to Ford. And Hughes, he's carried well, hasn't he? Look at this big mitt here.
Well, the difference is, Scott, just always the power runners from England. First of all, it's Hughes. Look at the speed of the ball from the breakdown. That's the difference. Scotland can't reorganise their defence. And really, that's the easiest of his three tries. It's a walk-in, but it's the ability of them bringing those runners round the corner. First Laws, then Hughes, getting over the gain line. And it's going to turning really ugly for Scotland now.
Are you happy with the last pass? Okay. Last thing for Ken.
The officials are happy with the pass, and foul with the simplest of conversions takes him
come
up
off. One
to 17
two.
Points.
One and two.
And Jonathan Joseph scoring an England hat-trick. He was the last to score a hat-trick in the Six Nations a year ago.
Yeah, it's electric feeder once again, but Hugh Jones had actually been calling Finn Russell to come in, come tighter. And this is where Scotland have got their defensive lines right. They've got to close this space down in the middle because Jonathan Joseph has been running amok in that area.
Well, Eddie Jones talked about the finishers getting England out of jail for the first three test matches. The finishers are going to have nothing left to finish the way it's going at the moment. It's been the starters who have been magnificent in this first half.
Vern Cotter has decided that it's time to make changes as Seymour runs into Hughes.
Oh, that's fine.
Gray gets up a little less than happy.
Nick, I think Seymour, not from this challenge, is actually in trouble. The reason being is that previously on that counter-attack from England, he got a serious knock to the head, and there's a discussion down pitch side as to whether he should have been continuing on.
Time is off. Captain, please.
Let's have another look at this.
I come, Maurice.
It's late. Just, there's nothing more than that. He's committed to it, but he would argue might just be a late tackle, which the referee's already pulled up on. He can pull out of that. It's a shot round the midriff, nothing more than that.
Let's have a listen to the referee.
When I blow the whistle, okay? I will check for the tackle. He's a late tackle. He's at least, for the moment, he's at least a yellow card. I will check with the TMO.
I'm hearing that it's going to be at least a yellow card for Nathan Hughes. I don't think the height of it suggests it'll be anything more than that.
Quite sure why it's a yellow card, quite frankly. He's hit him around the chest. What's wrong with that? It's a game of rugby, fella.
Let's have a listen to this.
Okay, I will just have a check.
Marius Matrea, the Italian touch judge.
Just have a check on the tackle on the number 8, White, please.
We will show you the dangerous tackle now.
Yeah, now, please.
There's nothing wrong with the height because it hits his chest. It's really just a question you suspect of it's how late it was. Yeah,
it is late, but it's not late that warrants a yellow card. I mean, the game's going silly if we're doing that.
What do you reckon, Scott?
That is correct, Matthew.
Yeah, late on the chest, but with the second one by England, the first one was the night tackle about the number 4 wide, and the first half, this one is the second one, so I will give a yellow card. Are you happy with that? Skinny?
Matthew?
I'm surprised at that.
Matthew, the tackler has attempted to wrap arms. It is just a late tackle.
Okay, so penalty kick, only a penalty kick, is it enough for you?
That is correct. Yeah. It is okay, just correct. A late tackle.
So we restart the game here for the late tackle.
Okay. Yes, correct.
Come in. No card. Okay, just a late tackle. It's not dangerous. It is dangerous.
It's
just a late tackle. Yeah, but we discussed and I changed my opinion. So it's a late tackle, it's penalty kick here. Okay.
In the meantime, Tommy Seymour has headed off for a head injury assessment, not the first we've had in this match.
Okay. Now, Duncan Weir's come off, so Scotland's bench is getting rather thin. And when you consider what is lying in a wait off England's bench, this is going to be an awkward second half for Scotland. 77% tackle completion, 5 of the 7 penalties have been at the breakdowns, 10 missed tackles. Players injured, Stuart Hawk, Tommy Seymour,
It's been a tough day at the office here at Twickenham. Duncan Weir has he gone to fullback? It looks like he has. And the Scotland defence just being bent out of shape at the moment. There's so many players. Hogg, Bennett, and now Seymour as Brown tests them again. The tackle comes in from Hugh Jones. Marler, 50 caps today.
Oh, five blues for Thunder Red.
Johnny Gray. Real problem for Scotland because the England runners are winning the collisions on their terms. Scotland aren't able to slow the ball down quick enough for the breakdown and almost forcing them into giving the penalties away just to stem the flow. First it was Launchbury that comes on a magnificent line, then Joe Marler. And look at that, Scotland just can't compete. Let's talk about this Scotland defence and just the restacking of the shelves that they've had to do, Scott. They've got Duncan Weir, ostensibly a 10 playing at fullback, and Ali Price, a scrum half, playing on the wing.
Yeah, I was very surprised. I thought Ali Price should go in at scrum half and leave Henry Purgos, the more experienced player, on the outside. But what has happened to Scotland is they have been absolutely rattled. And I was just looking up there and looking across to Scotland's left wing, Tim Visser. We haven't mentioned them in commentary. Scotland have just not won enough ball, and England are in command.
Tim Visser yet to carry the ball. He's not had his hands on the ball. Dead leg or not, injury scare or not, is kicking like a dream today. And England are into the 40s. England 40, Scotland 7.
Maybe still thinking, Eddie Jones, continuously about when and who to introduce and at what stage. Scotland compounding that now. It's going from bad to worse. That's two crucial errors in this second half. Scott unable to win the line out on England's 5-metre line. And then poor man Finn Russell just overdoing the kick. I mean, as well as England have played, and they have played fantastically for 47 minutes, you've got to look at Scotland and say that they've got a few things wrong here. Certainly the injuries we know about, you can't legislate for those, but their discipline at times and their tackling has really helped England.
Yeah, you're right. And just looking once again at the stats up here, Lawrence, you're 14 missed tackles. You know, you've got to keep your tackle count very much down in the low numbers there. And the unforced errors just creeping into Scotland's game time and time again. That's a feather in the cap. Scotland winning a penalty at the scrum.
Yeah, it's one of those that the ball got stuck in the tunnel. You know, England unable to strike the ball. And when you do that, you run the risk. They tried to push themselves off the ball, but unfortunately, they just wheeled it round, and I think it's Joe Marler that probably gets penalised. Just have a look at this. Just got their timing wrong. Rolled the ball in, but he didn't strike it. Hookers reluctant to lift their feet up, and then England get the drive going, but unable to stay square.
Scotland's new hooker is Ross Ford. The only man in the Scotland squad to have beaten England twice. It's going to be some story if he beats them three times. This is Richie Gray. 6'9", closing in on 20 stones. Taken up by Watson. Ninth cap for him, replacing the injured John Hardy. I haven't been able to see Watson at his best today yet either. 30 minutes to show us what they can do, to show us the real Scotland, the one that's played with so much vim and vigour in this championship so far.
Getting a wee bit of success with a pick and go through the middle. That's four or five phases where they've made metres.
Here's Watson again.
Just finding a few soft edges on England either side of the ruck. That'll give them some confidence to build.
Barkley quickly away to Ford.
who wins a couple of metres despite the efforts of Nathan Hughes. Richie Gray just protecting Scottish ball. Here's his brother. Having a little mind down that blind side again with Russell and the twinkling feet. Moving into Launchbury. Burgos again waits, as does the captain, Barkley, but it goes beyond him to Jones, and Jones scores! And Scotland have their second try.
Yeah, credit to Scotland, they've controlled that ball, and that little slip pass that puts some pace into the carry from the replacement hooker, Ross Ford, just found that space. Hugh Jones, as we've seen in his autumn series for Scotland, has an eye for this try line. Does very, very well, bouncing off Jonathan Joseph, reaching for the line. But Scotland were patient in that build-up.
Yeah, they tried to break England's defence, sort of one or two players outside the ruck, and they've had little success. But on this occasion, Scott, they do that pick and go really nicely, found those soft edges, and when they did go that little bit wider, Jones is able to break through.
Third test try for Hugh Jones. He scored a couple against Australia in the autumn, which really marked him out as something special for the future. And now he's scoring them in the Six Nations, the first of many, you would expect, you would hope. And that's a very good kick from Finn Russell as well. 7 much-needed points for Scotland. Try scored by Hugh Jones, born in Edinburgh, raised in England, studied in Cape Town, discovered by one of the Scottish analysts, and what a very good find he's proven to be. Dylan Hartley has been replaced by Jamie George for England. Nathan Hughes as well. Is Billy Vunipola, who's taken Nathan Hughes' place.
My fault, I blow the whistle too
quick. Big Billy back, first time in an England shirt since he hurt his knee here against Argentina in November. And 4 weeks ahead of schedule as well, he has beaten the doctor's predictions.
Yeah, he looks fit and well, doesn't he? Sometimes a rest is good news for a player, and it certainly looks like he's worked incredibly hard, not just on his injury, but his all-round game. And he's a firm favourite with the crowd. You can see they were dying for him to get his hands on the ball.
And he will want to influence from this game. He'll really want to make an impact.
Played 72 minutes for his club Saracens up in Newcastle at Kingston Park last Sunday. 72 minutes that proved to Eddie Jones and COVID he was fit to return to the test stage.
Good space, okay, we respect the space, the boss, okay, no pre-engage, and no push early, no early push, fine?
Conversation involving two youngsters in front row terms, Jamie George and Xander Ferguson, youngest Scotland prop to start in the championship for 69 years.
No pre-engage, scratch!
On the WP nail, he's still recovering from a neck injury, so Ferguson has been thrown into the deep end and has all the time.
Both sides just having a little bit of problems here. It's not staying square and stable. Referee probably given one more go at this, and then we don't get the ball in. I'm pretty sure he'll penalise one of these two sides.
Hearing, by the way, that poor old Tommy Seymour, the latest to fail a head injury assessment, so Duncan Weir is now with us until the conclusion of this contest. It's been a tale of injury woe for Scotland, among several tales of woe, but the injuries have not helped.
Bind! Set!
England now with Billy Vunipola firing the engine, controlling it, winning the penalty.
honest, there wasn't a huge amount of difference from that scrum from the previous one, but with Scotland got awarded the penalty on this occasion, England perhaps going forward that little bit quicker and earlier on in the set. And Owen Farrell sizing up the corner. Let's just have another look at this scrum. Slightly better channel this time, and England just get that. Again, tight head just turns himself in, and Marler takes full advantage.
Jamie George with Billy Bonapola just readjusting his position in the lineout, and he, in the end, was a lifter to get his clubmate Itoje highest of all.
Big Billy's got his hands on the ball. Wonder whether Courtney Laws has just taken it off in there. They've got this under control, and England moving forward.
Scotland's defence being stretched very nearly to breaking point again. Vonopola having to turn his back to it, though, and England will need to press the reset button. Scotland trying to keep that ball off the floor, which they have done very well, and little victories that John Barkley's celebrating.
Yeah, it's a good for Scotland to repel, although the referee's now taken exception to...
Well, you can celebrate little victories a little bit too much, and that's what John Barkley did just then.
Well, you know what's going to happen next. It's in the corner, and another drive will come on, and 5 metres for England to pile on the pressure.
It's got a little bit impatient, England, at the back there. Yeah, they had that ball under control. James Haskell just using all his experience. That's frustration. That's all that is when you're... First half performance in the scoreline.
Once again, it's Itoje. Once again. Tucking it into the arms of the forwards, and once again they're over the Scotland line. And it looks like Billy Vunipola has marked his comeback in the grand style. Vunipola scores England's fifth try. He's only been on the pitch for a couple of minutes, and they continue to stretch ahead in the Calcutta Cup.
Well, that's what you call a player who's taking things into his own hands. On the first drive, he gave the ball back to Courtney Laws. It didn't work for England on this occasion. That's him and Launchbury together. He decides not to do that.
Yeah, it was Vunipola. He was right. He was at the scrum half position. He latched onto the ball, and England were tight there, splintering that Scottish defence.
Yeah, look at this. Really good work as well from Launchbury. He's perfectly legal there because he started that position, and he's the one that just carves open the hole, and you're not going to stop Vunipola from there.
For Jonathan Joseph, who takes his lead, having scored a hat-trick. Meantime, Owen Farrell continues to collect points. He's now got 22. England are up to 47, which is their biggest ever score in the Calcutta Cup.
Yeah, I'm more concerned. I'm looking at the clock at the top of your screens. We're going into the last quarter. England will have their finishers off the bench. It's damage limitation for Scotland.
Yeah, Clive Woodward talked about England winning the second half. It's, what, 17-7 now to England in the second half, and they'll be trying to build on that.
Ben Teo is on for Jonathan Joseph. He's hanging around here, and he needs to make the hit on Russell, which he does. Mike Brown was over that ball. He might have done enough to win it back. Scotland having to send in more reinforcements. Jonathan Joseph, the fourth Englishman to score a hat-trick in the Calcutta Cup, getting a cuddle from his captain, Dylan Parker.
Well, he's been magnificent, and you know, when you talk to Bath fans, they'll tell you, they'll sing the praises of that player, Jonathan Joseph, and tell you about how good he is, and seen too much of it in a Bath shirt this season, but he saved his best for today. I'm sure Warren Gatland knows how to spell Joseph.
down to Pergos quickly, and Russell and Wilson has not stopped. It's been a grisly, gruesome afternoon for Scotland, but still doing what they can with Russell. And here goes Ali Price, who's been stationed on the wing for much of the match when he'd have been expecting to be whirring around the engine, around the scrums and the breakdowns. Dennis Watson making the ball, making sure the ball is there for Pergos to use again, and now Barkley. Pergos. A little look, ball was half ajar, but not for long.
This is really good line speed from England. First Haskell, then Farrell just getting up, and Scotland just getting forced further and further behind the gain line.
Tim Visser with his hands on the ball. Again, not for long. Back to Jones as quickly as he could. Battle for possession on the halfway. Pergos and Visser again. And here goes Alan Dell. Playing in his seventh test since his debut in November. His first against England. And Finn Russell. Seeing if there's any space around Mike Brown, which there wasn't. And Brown, wonderful spiral kick, finding some distance.
Just an indication here of how Owen Farrell closes down the options for Finn Russell. Watch this, as Scotland attack and try and recycle. Top of your picture, up comes Owen Farrell, closes the options, and Scotland can't get to the wide channels, which has brought them so successfully in previous games.
A couple more England changes. Dan Cole and Ben Youngs, the two Leicester boys, being replaced by Harlequins. It's Danny Kerr at scrum half and Kyle Stinkler on the tight head side of England scrum.
No. I'm off.
And Scotland have made a change as well at tight head. Xander Fagerson for Simon Bergen.
No, middle.
Edinburgh
no,
middle. Prop, debut in the defeat in Paris. New face, winning his second cap, Bergen. The tail of that line-out, which was Scotland's, but is very quickly England's ball again. Watson. This is Weir. Going to run out at Twickenham for the first time. Ford, Brown. Watson. Ball down by Dell. Goes Courtney Laws. Scotland readying themselves to give a debut to Cornel Dupria. And he's about to come on for Ryan Wilson as England try to unpick some knots again with Noel. Yet to lose a match at Twickenham, Jack Noel. This is his ninth. Into the final quarter of this latest Calcutta Cup encounter. And that looked nasty.
Really nasty. Jonathan Joseph just running a really sharp line, and he's bleeding from the head as well. That was a really big collision.
It's Ryan Wilson, Scott, who took the blow.
Well, we've seen so many head knocks within the game, and it's the speed of the game and the players throwing themselves at the tackle area. Scotland are about to lose another player, I'm afraid.
My goodness, this has been an attritional contest.
Yeah, it has been, and Scotland were in exactly the same situation against France, but they managed to hang into this game. But England have totally exploited the Scotland defence. There's Jamie George, isn't it? And Ryan Wilson just getting his timing wrong in the tackle.
He also gets his head on the wrong side, doesn't he? That's the problem. You know, you've got to get your head lower than that, because you can be sure that the runner coming on is going to definitely duck his head.
Well, it's good to see that he's making his way off the pitch of his own volition. He's in the best of hands with James Robson alongside him, and Cornel Dupria will come on. That was scheduled anyway, but Dupria on. But the story of the match provided by England and their try scorers and their hat-trick man Jonathan Joseph.
Yeah, I love the way he uses his feet, and as I mentioned earlier in my commentary, you fear pace, and he's such a graceful runner when he steps on the gas like that.
Yeah, and he's certainly been profiting from some wonderful hands from Young, Ford and Farrell. That access have really opened up the holes for Joseph to run in the tries.
And I think it's that precision that has made England look so good today. We sometimes underestimate those qualities, the weight, the depth of pass, the players who hold on to the ball and create space for others.
We've noticed that Dylan Hartley's back with us, having lit up the proverbial cigar. He's had to stub it out again because Jamie George has gone off for some blood attention in that collision with Ryan Wilson, so we need a hooker, and the captain is back with us.
Yeah, no such luxury in the front row these days. When you got replaced, you got replaced in the old days, but such is the modern game. You've got to be ready to come straight back on.
We're in 20 for Scotland at the base of that scrum. Dupreer on his debut. This is Ben Teo, the Worcester man. Scored one of the nerve-settling, frustration-easing tries against Italy a fortnight ago.
Release now!
After 93 seconds into his Six Nations debut against France. And he's on now, and this is Farrell, and here goes Brown, who again has clocked up the metres today. Snatched behind his back by Courtney Laws. Laws has rediscovered the zest of old. The sinker doesn't take long to find Billy Vunipola.
Yeah, just the abundance of possession coming England's way. They've made 430 metres in this match compared to Scotland's 161, so it's really a white line there of attacking ball-carrying Englishmen.
Ball's been lost forward by Vunipola.
Come back here.
Frustration from a Scotland perspective is that having picked that back row, and with that back row having played so well, arch ferret so far in the championship, they've just not been able to put their own game on England, Lawrence.
Well, I think right from the start the problem for Scotland has been that, you know, the game was almost lost in the opening quarter of the match, and once you've done that, it's very hard to find a way back in. And you know, they picked a pacey back row, but really that back row hasn't worked for them in terms of what they face from England. They've not been able to get to the midfield and help out that midfield defence.
It's really interesting because look at the carries, it's almost the same.
Well, Scotland have had that. Remember, their two tries have come from some very good solid pick and drive play where they've picked off some areas in England's defensive patterns, but just on England, the way they're able to command the possession, and of course their defence has been very good as well. They've squeezed the life out of Scotland, put them under real pressure, and it's Scotland who've suffered under that pressure because they've made the most mistakes. They've conceded penalties, they've had handling errors, and the most important thing from their defence is that they've missed tackles.
As horrendous as that scoreline looks for Scottish fans, they have scored two tries. There's plenty of time in this game, and you know, I know it's clutching at straws, but they do have to try and chase the bonus point, because for Scotland, with Italy coming up next weekend, you know, who knows what might happen in terms of wanting to finish up that table as high as possible.
The possibility of overtaking Ireland in the world rankings. Ireland currently fourth, Scotland fifth, highest they've ever been, and if they can squeeze into the top four, it'll make May's World Cup draw for the tournament in Japan in 2019 that much simpler. They'll be in the top four, they'll avoid the big boys. They would have been there if they'd won this match, even if they'd have drawn it. So a fair way off right now with 15 minutes to go, but Jones and Visser, hope springing eternal, and Visser finally doing what we know he can do for the first time in the match, but only in the end finding four.
There's a lovely little in-and-out pass from Finn Russell that just got England caught going backwards on the edge there. They had no real opportunity to beat England on the outside, but it's a lovely piece of skill. And Jack Knowles just got caught in no-man's land there.
Yeah, the overhead pass here into no-man's land, intercepted there by George Ford.
More England changes. Say farewell to Courtney Laws, and we welcome to the stage Tom Wood, on for the 49th time in a test match. He's worked hard to change Eddie Jones' initial doubts about his long-term international quality. And very much part of this game. This is Watson. Henry Purgos. Johnny Gray. Turns 23 on Tuesday, Johnny Gray. And England starting to manhandle people, but it's Scotland who go through the middle, and that's nice from Visser. He's just getting that much more involved. Extremely mobile, HGV when he starts to motor, but again, not the accuracy having made that initial break. And England will have it back.
England made amends for the missed tackle by just doing enough for the breakdown to rip the ball out.
And Russell thought about going quickly, but England had lined up just in case.
I think when we look at the stats, that just the difference for me in terms of the carries and the metres made has just been huge. Tim Visser hardly had an opportunity to get his hands on the ball. We know how dangerous he is, both for Quins and Scotland. Gets in, but I think it's Mike Brown that gets in there and just rips the ball away before the referee, Shannon Ruck. Good work from Brown.
Plays his rugby across the A316 for Harlequins with that man. Clubmates ordinarily, but foes today. Well, Brown has played 17th championship win in a row for him, by the way, would equal the record set by the great Wales lot, Jeff Wheel, in the late 1970s. That's the run that England and Mike Brown are on right now. Turgos digs it out.
Away!
And again, link provided by the captain, Barkley.
Yeah, the one bright spot of Scotland's performance has been sometimes their pick and drive play and then the second pass out of contact.
No. No. Stop. Time off. No.
Just frustrated.
No.
Every time.
Richie, please. Richie. If you want a penalty kick, let him a chance to roll away, okay? Not holding on the player, it will be a scrum, okay? Thank you.
Referee just explaining to Richie Gray, if you're looking for a penalty, you've got to let the player roll away of his own volition. Don't try and hold him in there and win the penalty. Bit of cute work from Richie Gray, but referee's just that little bit cuter on this occasion.
Yeah, I also like the way he just called him over, says Richie. There's obviously a referee due in Toulouse. As he just brings in his man, just rolls over the top of the man, keeps the ball, keeps the man waiting there.
Is that a French accent? How wise of you not to attempt it?
Ah, oui, monsieur.
Stay by.
Picked up by Dupré. And that's Jones continuing to take the fight to England. And now Russell, and opening up space once more for Visser. Threat on the right wing this time, getting much more involved. Russell once more, and Gray, and he's hit back and hit back hard by Sinclair, but it'll open up again for Scotland. Still some work to do to score the try, but how well Hugh Jones did. He'll be playing his rugby in Scotland next season. He's leaving Cape Town behind for Glasgow. And he'll be heading to the Warriors as a Six Nations try scorer.
Yeah, Scotland playing with so much heart, aren't they? You've got to admire the way they're still trying to stretch this England defence. I thought there was an offload possibility there from Visser, but the space was always out wide. And again, it's Finn Russell who loops round Alan Dell, by the way. Great hands for the prop forward. And Hugh Jones, he's caught the eye once again with this mazy running.
Well, it's all about Scotland getting front football, you know, which has been in short supply in this match. And the forwards haven't been able to penetrate England, and it's been left up to the backs. And it's really Tim Visser was the catalyst that made the initial break, and then Jones able to finish off.
In the face of a storm, Finn Russell has kicked like a peach today. That was another wonderful kick.
Yeah, and you know, Lawrence did mention a couple of minutes ago that Scotland might look for a bonus point, and look at the loop round pass here from Finn Russell to Dell. He cuts a line, and Scotland, with 10 minutes to go, can take something out of this game of rugby. If they could get one more try, then that's a bonus point. Those who rubbished bonus points in this championship will just watch as the next 10 minutes unfolds.
And the world rankings are so complicated, we'd need to devote the entire evening to explain why, if Scotland can finish within 15 points, it could be significant in terms of the top four. But there is still some pieces for Scotland to play for here, as Dylan Hartley again makes way and Jamie George returns to join the fun.
Yeah, I think the penalty is just the Scottish runners were in front of the box kick quite a considerable way, so a bit of a soft one to give away, especially when you've just scored and you need possession again. And England will look to lock this one down. Let's have another look, just way in front, won't they?
Yeah, Ali Price on this side. And Lawrence, you mentioned it previously, that when Scotland have scored, their set-piece restarts have been awful.
There's Jamie George back on the pitch, of course. Head bandaged up.
Once again, the first choice double top is Mauro Itoje. And England are running it and looking for another score, and they've got it. And Danny Kerr, as he did against Italy, mauls his way over the line, and England hit half a dozen.
Well, it's a beautiful line that he takes against the grain. Often players sort of run laterally. Billy Bonapola just takes the ball round the front, round the back there. And look, the just space opens up. It's far too easy for him to get over the gain line. Just runs across, back inside, and Scotland have got to loosen up. Their loose forwards have got to work away from the driving maul.
Yeah, they're going to work collectively and be tighter and then fan. And what seems to be happening in Scotland's defensive lines is the fan is already there and they're trying to close the gaps. And England exploiting space once again.
Six tries, Owen Farrell with a personal haul of 24. Danny Kerr, 70th cap for Kerr today, is just seven shy of the watching Matt Dawson now in terms of England's scrum half records and adding to the try-scoring tally.
Yeah, just Hamish Watson just a little bit too eager to move on to the outside. It just opens up too big a space between himself and the other Scottish defence.
By Ali Price. Pergos is now the scrum half and hit hard at Itoje on Russell. Haven't fried themselves on their fitness. They've worked so hard on that area of the game over the last 12 months under Eddie Jones. And as much as Scotland want to end this hard, so do England.
Be some interesting selections for Eddie Jones in that final game of the championship, because obviously Billy Bonapola has already made his colossal presence felt. Let's hope Anthony Watson will still be available for selection. He looks in a bit of discomfort there with his shoulder. Let's have a look how this happened here. Oh, you don't want to run into Carl Sinclair, that's for sure. That's friendly fire.
Oh, you can feel it up here, can't you?
Billy Bonapola to Danny Kerr, and then Tio running hard, and now George likewise. Launchbury, it's been on from the off, no lessening of the pace. Haskell, Itoje was in close proximity. 5 minutes to go. Tom Wood for England.
That's fine. Really simple patterns of play from England.
Kerr having to do some clearing out at that ruck. Some help from Wood. Because Kerr was buried. George will be scrum half to find Haskell. Wrestles off Tim Swinson, who's with us.
Watch me.
Thank you.
Ford to Farrell.
to Teo, to Watson. Not this time. And in the losing cause, Hugh Jones has again caught the eye. Ball in hand, and on that occasion, trying to repel England.
Yeah, he did, but England were so good in their attack play, weren't they? The amount of times they got over the gain line. And well, watch it here, Lawrence.
Yeah, I mean, just the simplicity of it. Vunipola, Danny Kerr to Bentier. You've got a big man, you bring him on, just make him do what he's good at. And then you've got Jamie George coming round the corner, straightening the line, again getting over the gain line, and Launchbury. And that's been the difference. One, two, three, nice and simple. And for the first time on this occasion, England don't straighten in the backs and they're shepherded into touch. But it's a power game from England.
Still one more weekend of the RBS Six Nations to go. England will go to Dublin as the champions again. They're going to retain the title with this win. A not inconsiderable matter of the Grand Slam, however. Still very much up for grabs. And we'll be in Dublin for Ireland against England next Saturday tea time here on ITV.
It's a huge game, mouth-watering game, with Ireland's defeat to Wales. The championship's gone, but there's still places on that plane to New Zealand up for grabs, and they'll be desperate, Ireland, to ruin the party for England and stop them getting first back-to-back Grand Slams in the Six Nations.
One stop!
England's great. Time, Lawrence, RBS Six Nations man of the match. Who's caught your eye most of all?
Well, I think the performances from the men in white have been outstanding. Certainly Maratoji, Courtney Laws had a fantastic game. I thought the distribution and the points from the boot of Owen Farrell have been magnificent, but you can't look beyond the hat-trick hero, Joseph. He's been magnificent, really, really back to his very, very best, and he set the tone right from the start.
Yeah, but the beauty about the 15-man game is others contribute and others excel. And this man has been sublime in the way he runs and carries the ball. Defensively, he made some good tackles as well. And laying on tries. But it's been a porous defence for him to run at. But you've got to provide the ball.
The other England hat-trick scorers, by the way, just in case you were wondering, I suspect you weren't, in the Calcutta Cup, Jamie Noone, John Carlton, who you will probably remember, Cyril Lowe, might need some prompting in the early 20th century, 1914, he was scoring his tries.
England could finish off with one, which will be their seventh. It's a mess, scrum.
Taken up again by Billy Vunipola. England heading towards a record score on the Calcutta Cup. Won't be a record win. It won't beat the 43-3 margin in 2001.
Away, blue!
With a table full of prizes to play for today, England go away with the bulk of them. But again, it's good defensive work this time from Duncan Weir, denying Jack Noll.
Not sure England needed that option, to be honest. I thought they were battering away. The forwards are so powerful, so hungry to come onto the ball. I know Ford wants to create something there, but Noll was always going to be second best to that. Weir does really well to turn his back and still keep his eyes on the ball. The Ford's defence, he obviously knew that the referee was playing advantage. So it's a shot to nothing, as they say. We're back to where we were 30 seconds ago.
Yeah, and England just going to finish off the game here, putting pressure on the Scotland, just as they did when they came out of the traps at the start of the game. Tremendous game between these two nations. Scotland trying to hang in there, but England's dominance coming to the fore throughout this 80 minutes.
Big push for England, but
both front foot get up together.
Two front rows, but
scrum again.
Things are tingling together, so one more scrum, 30 seconds to go.
A little bit louder, I can't hear this. Okay, that's fine.
England's 11th championship win in a row is a new record. They've overtaken the exploits of the England team in the 1880s and in the 1920s. And say what you like about
this Eddie Jones squad. They're seeing records, they're targeting them, and they're overtaking them. And they are going to win back-to-back Six Nations titles for the first time in Six Nations history as well.
If you win as many as 18 test matches, you can't play them all here at Twickenham. You know, you've got to go on the road as well, and I think that's been what's been so impressive about this England side, because winning at Twickenham is one thing, taking that game on the road and doing it consecutively, that man deserves a huge amount of credit.
Killing the team that did the job in 2000 and 2001.
Okay, boys. No, but the boss, we cannot play a loyal scrum, okay? You and you.
We're going to Dublin next weekend, but still so much to play for.
We just want to play a scrum, okay?
Scotland will wrap up their Six Nations at home to Italy. Looking to finish that with a tick on a positive note, because it has been, apart from today, a very positive Scotland Six Nations, Scott.
Yeah, very much so. But Italy will fancy their chances coming to Murrayfield. But Scotland have to realise they've brought so much to this championship, so much to the cause. Just beaten by the better team today.
Use it now.
Vonnapola. One last England surge, maybe one last England try, looking for a seventh. Itoje held up determinedly by Tim Swinson and co.
Ninth.
Scotland's defence reorganising itself. Sinclair. Billy Vonnapola's looking ominous. Swinson's seen him, but it goes behind him to Brown instead. Ball's spat loose, picked up by Haskell.
Hands up, Blue!
Anthony Watson on the shorter blind side to the left, but it's right they go, and again, Vonnapola. And again, Itoje. He doesn't hold on to it long, and Noel will have to go backwards. There are 3-4 Scotland shirts that he has to negotiate. Got past one of them, but not the second, Hamish Watson, although he did well to make some ground. Kerr snatches it up. Launchbury was an option, but instead it's Ford who threads it along the ground. Picked up by Brown, shrugs off Russell. Still Brown's going. Long bursting end to this contest. Kerr to Itoje to George. Scotland utterly determined there will be no more scoring. There's another penalty coming. Here comes Vonnapola. And this is Brown.
Desperation from Scotland. Just trying to hold on to the ball, to tackle anything to keep England out one last time.
So Hemlock, Hemlock!
Noel.
Ford. Farrell lays it up for Launchbury. Still they go, England. What fitness from both sides. And this is Marco Vonnapola. And this is Danny Kerr, and England will have seven. That is cruel on Scotland. But it's been a cruel afternoon for a team who came here with so much hope, but have just been dispatched by an England team in full sail.
Absolutely, and you're looking at a team playing with bags of confidence. The magnificent seven, the seventh try from Danny Kerr.
They just kept battering the door down, didn't they? Just the power runners that England have got, the recognition of where the space is, and the ability to break the first tackle. Admittedly, it's in the 84th minute of the game. There's a lot of tired Scottish bodies out there, but they just keep coming round the corner with more and more forward power.
Significance of this kick for Owen Farrell, if he gets it, it'll be a record equaling Calcutta Cup win for England. For Scotland, it's been a bit of a Calcutta cupping. Came here with so much hope, but for England,
They've retained the RBS Six Nations Championship. They're champions again. One more step on the road to the Grand Slam. Final score at Twickenham, England 61, Scotland 21.